Thank you. Se malo više naprijed, da ne bude svi pozadnji, da.
Da ne treba Maharaj vika previše.
A ne, imamo se čuje previše, imamo zvuči.
Da, dobro zvuči. Ja sam na aparat.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, is a glorification of the personality of God. Bhagavatam consists of philosophical teachings about the nature of the Absolute Truth. Devotional service to the Absolute Truth and the results of devotional service to the Absolute Truth. Love for Krishna. Seems to be a little echo here. You're hearing both the translation and the English?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That could be a little bit of a problem. Can you do without
microphones?
Without the microphone?
Koliko osoba treba prijevod? Možete jednu truku, ono... Ona truk je dosta blizu, malo pa da pričam bez...
Okay. Let me know if everything is easily heard. Okay. So... And Bhagavatam consists of many prayers, prayers by great souls, such as the Prachetas, prayers by Narada Muni, prayers by Lord Brahma, prayers by Queen Kunti, prayers by Kardama Muni, prayers by Kashyapa Muni. Bhagavatam consists a lot of glorification of the Lord through offering beautiful prayers to the Lord. The Lord is glorified in different ways, from different angles of vision, by different personalities, who have realized something about the glory and the position of the Lord. One of the names of the Lord is Bhagavan. And Bhagavan means one who is complete in all opulences, all strength, all fame, all wealth, all knowledge, all beauty, and ultimately all renunciation. In this world, people have these qualities in some small portion, and some have these qualities in more than others. But no one can have all the qualities in full and complete and perfect, except the source, which is Bhagavan or Krishna. But Krishna is not so glorified so much for his qualities of strength, beauty, knowledge, fame, wealth, and renunciation. He's famous for these. He's performed many wonderful activities, showing extraordinary strength, such as a little boy lifting the Govardhan Hill when he was only 7.5 years old. No child of that age could pick up a huge mountain and hold it for 7 days and 7 nights in a continuous rainstorm and constantly smiling during the whole time. So his strength is incomparable. And he did it not with his, sometimes you see, a caricature of the Lord where this great big muscle-bound person is struggling to keep the world on his back, and he's called Atlas. But for Krishna to hold up, you know, a mountain with his finger, it's easy. He doesn't even have to think about it, he just does it. In fact, just by his will it happens. So his strength is inconceivable. For his devotees, he's known by his beauty, We see the beautiful form of the Lord, the form of the deity, and he comes in different manifestations of that form. And we take darshan, we see the beautiful form of the Lord, and our eyes become, what we say, enchanted by that form. His smile, the way he holds his flute, the beautiful form of his transcendental body. All of his qualities and characteristics are so exquisite and perfect that it captures the minds and hearts of those who worship him. And his sweet smile on the face is glorified by the acharyas as the sweetest thing of Krishna's beauty. And when Krishna smiles, everyone becomes happy. So we can go through the whole list, his wealth, his fame. He spoke the Bhagavad Gita more than 5,000 years ago, and it's still being read and spoken about now. So who's that famous? But there's one quality that I didn't mention out of these six that is even more glorious than all of these six put together. And there's a beautiful prayer in the sixth chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, 19th chapter, which describes his qualities of beauty, strength, wealth, all these qualities. But it prefaces all these as, "You are the most merciful." So out of all of his qualities, his mercy is the most glorious. How does he show his mercy? How does he exhibit his mercy? In that purport, it's described that sometimes the Lord's temple is being neglected or being run down, and it's not being taken care of. So the Lord will appear to the dream of one of his devotees and say, "Take care of my temple." And the devotee will immediately do something to take care of his temple. Just like after Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu discovered Radhakund, after having been hidden for so many hundreds of years, thousands of years actually, after the disappearance of Lord Sri Krishna. Then it was just a little pond, and it needed a lot of attention in order to bring it back to its original state as Radhakund. So Raghunath Das Goswami was living at Radhakund, and he was very concerned that here is the most spiritually elevated place, the bathing place of Srimati Radharani, whose pure bhakti is the highest expression of bhakti that is understandable, not understandable, that is what we say available in all of existence, and it's being neglected. So he wanted to do something in order to bring back the glory of Srimati Radharani's bathing place, Radhakund. But he was a renunciate. He had nothing. And he was thinking, how am I going to get money? And even if I, why should I try to get money? Because money and renunciation as a sadhu, this just doesn't go together. So he simply prayed. And one day, some very wealthy man was traveling to Badrinath. Badrinath is in the Himalayas, very far away from Radhakund. He would go every year to take darshan of his deity Badri Vatsal. So the first night he arrived there, and of course he brought a large financial donation for Badrinarayan, and that night he fell asleep, and his Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Go to Vrindavan, take that money and give it to Raghunath Das Goswami and let him renovate Radhakund." So he didn't know who Raghunath Das Goswami was. He wasn't sure he knew what Radhakund was. He was more than 1,000 miles away from Vrindavan. But hearing the prayer or the plea of his Lord in a dream, he simply left and after some time arrived in Vrindavan, found Raghunath Das Goswami, offered those great wealth in the Lord, and Raghunath Das Goswami arranged for Srimati Radharani's birthplace, or a bathing place, to come back to its original state after she had left. So the Lord appears in his dream, in a person's dream, inspires that person to do something, and arranges for the facility to do something. And what does he do? He gives credit to his devotee. That's his mercy. Here's the point. The point is that the Lord is all-powerful. Prabhupada would say, if he wants, he could have spread Krishna consciousness all around the world by himself. He needs nobody else to do it. All-powerful means all-powerful. When you say all-powerful, that means there's no limit to what that person who is described as all-powerful can perform. So Krishna is all-powerful. Prabhupada said Krishna is so powerful that he can take day and make it night, and take night and make it day. And I tried to figure that one out. Not to change day into night, night into day. But it's inconceivable by our own minds. But Krishna not only is conceivable to him, it's easily done. So this is the nature of the all-powerful Supreme Personality of Godhead. But he doesn't do things directly. He does everything through his devotees. And where does he give the credit? To his devotees. So Prabhupada said, Lord Chaitanya, who is Krishna himself, could have spread Krishna consciousness all over the world when he was here 500 years ago. And when Prabhupada was asked, why didn't he do it? And Prabhupada said, he left it for me. He wants to glorify his devotee. He wants to show the beauty of those who surrender to him in loving devotional service. The Lord gives the facility. He makes the arrangements. He gives the intelligence. He gives the power. Everything. He gives everything. And then the devotee carries it out. And the devotee gets the credit. That's Krishna's mercy. He doesn't want to take credit for himself. But of course, the devotee is always thinking, I didn't do it. It's only by the mercy of the Lord that this is able to be done. So here we are. We're, in order to perform devotional service successfully, progressively, mercy is required. One's personal endeavor can attract mercy, but the endeavor itself cannot accomplish the goal. The goal only comes when Krishna gives his mercy. So we're chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. But where does the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra come from? It comes from Goloka. Goloka Premadana, Harinam, Sankirtan. It comes from the spiritual world into the material world, into the hearts of his pure devotees. His pure devotees travel all over, spreading the holy name and everywhere. Everyone benefits. And the Lord is pleased by that, and everyone makes spiritual progress. So it's the Lord himself who arranges everything, and that is called his mercy. There's no more one more merciful than God. Now, if you know someone who has wealth, who has some fame, maybe, some position, or some, what we say, outstanding resources, that person becomes popular in this world, right? A person who has a lot of wealth, you hear about them. A person who has maybe big fame or created something, just like, you know, one person made Apple computers, right? And became famous for that. He just came up with the idea how to put these computers together, right? So where does he get the knowledge from? Krishna says, Sarvasya Amritisani Visto, Matam Svirti Agyanam Apo Anam Cha. From me comes knowledge, remembrance. And if somebody forgets something, it's me that causes them to forget. Knowledge, remembrance, and forgetfulness are facilities that come from the heart, which the Lord inspires either way. Either he gives you knowledge, makes you forget something, or he helps you to remember. The Krishna in the heart is giving us the mercy accordingly. So in the form of the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, here's the means for purifying our existence, tasting the happiness of spiritual life, and what we say, achieving spiritual perfection, all in one package. If you get, just like there's a little story. One man, he's blind, he doesn't have any children, and he has no place to live. Quite a pitiable scene, isn't it? No children, no money, no place to live, nothing. Somehow or other he meets a sadhu, and then he pleases the sadhu. The sadhu is powerful. He says, because you have pleased me, you can ask for me a benediction. You can either ask for a palace to live in, children to have, or the vision to see. So which one does he take? He says to the sadhu, I want to see my children while I'm standing on the top of my palace.
Humble.
That's Krishna consciousness. If you're Krishna conscious, you get everything. You don't have to try for something separately. It's all in one package. This is the mercy of Krishna's holy name, that everything is there in the holy name. Therefore, the holy name is so merciful. The holy name can attract Krishna. The holy name is so powerful that even Krishna is attracted by his own name. There's a beautiful story in the pastimes of Radha and Krishna in Vrindavan, where when you were kids, did you ever play this game called hide and seek? Yeah, everybody plays that. I remember playing it too. So, you know, you take one person, you blindfold them, and then everybody hides, and then they take the blindfold off, and then they have to find out where everybody's hiding. And if you get caught, you lose, right? So Radharani was blinded, and all the gopis went different places, and Krishna went really far away on a mountain behind a tree. And so Radharani is trying to find him. Because Radharani is so spiritually sweet, as soon as she comes near someone, they can't not reveal themselves. So as soon as she gets near one of the gopis, they start laughing, or they start speaking, and then she catches them. She doesn't even have to find them, because as soon as Radharani comes near, they can't hide anymore. It's impossible. But Krishna, now he's really strong. He can hide from Radharani. So he's hiding, and she's looking all over. She can't find him. And even when she gets close to him, he switches positions and goes somewhere else. So Radharani's trying to find him. And then she thinks, I know. She starts chanting Hare Krishna. And she starts chanting the Maha Mantra. And she sings it so sweetly and with so much beautiful devotion that Krishna gets stunned and he can't move. He's trying to get away from Radharani, but the singing of Radharani enters into his heart and mind, and he becomes like a wooden doll that can't go one way or the other and can't even speak. He's stunned, and then she catches him. She wins. So this is the holy name. The holy name is so merciful that it can capture the person who is the source of that same mercy. So therefore, we cannot understand the glories of Krishna's mercy. I was making the point before that if a person in this world has one of so many, what we say, opulences, wealth, fame, beauty, but they're not merciful, who cares? Right? A person who is not merciful towards others, although they have so much, it may be popular for them. Just like the story in the 11th canto of the Avanti Brahman. The Avanti Brahman was a very, very wealthy Brahman. He had a big family, and he used his wealth simply to accumulate more and more wealth. He was cruel to other people. No one liked him, not even his family members. But because he had such power and wealth, people stuck with him because they were wanting the wealth also. Then Providence changed the whole thing. He lost everything. And when he lost everything, everybody just left him. Nobody cared for him anymore. Why? Because he was, although he had so much, he wasn't kind and merciful towards others. Now you see, even the opposite. If someone doesn't have much materially, but they're a kind person by nature, and they show their kindness in whatever way they can towards others, everyone's attracted to that. Everyone is attracted to that because that quality is so beautiful that attracts even the attention of the Lord. But when we understand that therefore all of Krishna's qualities and opulences all together cannot compare to his opulence of mercy. And how he shows his mercy simply by glorifying his devotee. He allows his devotee to do something and gives his devotee the credit. He gives devotee the mercy of the holy name. The holy name brings one's consciousness to Krishna, and Krishna thanks the devotee for being so devoted, although it was his mercy. A parent has a child and gives the child the allowance. The child goes out and spends the allowance to buy the parent a present. The parent says, "Oh, you are so nice. You are so kind. Thank you very much." It was the parent's money. But because the child used it to give a gift to the parents, to show some affection for the parent, that was the perfection of the relationship. Not so much the gift. So this is Krishna. Krishna's pleased when he sees his devotees taking what he gives him, them, and using it in devotional service. He gives us intelligence. We use it in devotional service, you get more. He gives you wealth, money, you use it in devotional service, he gives you more. In the material world, if you use something, you get less of what it is. But in Krishna consciousness, because it's coming from Krishna, and Krishna appreciates that, whatever you use, you get more. This works with time also. You use your time for Krishna, he gives you more time. You use your talents for Krishna, your talents grow more. That's the nature of Krishna. I know this one devotee in India, he's a very wealthy man. And when he first met Srila Prabhupada, he was inspired very much by Srila Prabhupada. He hosted Prabhupada at his house along with all the devotees at the time. And then he wanted to take initiation from Prabhupada, but Prabhupada left the planet before he had the chance. So he was all very sad about that. So he took shelter one of Prabhupada's senior Vaishnava spiritual masters and became a devotee himself. Now he uses all his wealth, and he's very wealthy, multi-millionaire, for Krishna consciousness, helping with many projects around the world. And he tells us, because I know him personally, he says, "Krishna just keeps giving me more and more money. I keep spending it, he just gives me more." So this is Krishna consciousness. Whatever you use, you get more. Because Krishna says, oh, you actually understand the importance of this, whatever you have, time, intelligence, facilities, abilities, talents, whatever you have. And you use it? Krishna gives you more. That's Krishna consciousness. And it's all coming from Krishna. And if Krishna wants, he can take it all. As fast as he gives it, he can also take it away. How do we lose it? One will become proud of it. Oh, I did it. It's because of me. I have these qualities. We take credit for ourselves, not recognizing the source. And then Krishna starts to gradually remove in order to destroy that pride. Because Krishna doesn't like pride. If you're good at something, the tendency is to become proud of that. You might say, oh, glories to my spiritual master. But you're also thinking, some glory for me, right? I did it. Sometimes we say 90% glories for Prabhupada and 10% for me. Well, you only want 10%, that's all. No, I'm not asking so much. One tenth. So the tendency of the conditioned soul is sometimes to take credit or to own the results of our activities. And Krishna will let that go on for some time until it gets too out of hand, and then he'll smash it. And then the devotee starts to think, what happened? What happened? I used to be able to... And Krishna thinks it all. Why? Because he wants the devotee to become humble. Because the humility is the means for attracting the attention of Krishna and everything. His Holiness Sachinandana Maharaj makes a nice point about humility. He says that just like there's a fruit, and the fruit is the best part, and on the fruit there's the skin. What value does the skin have? It protects the fruit. But we don't really take much importance of the skin. In fact, we take the skin off and throw it, and we're interested in the fruit. But the skin of the fruit protects the fruit, and therefore the fruit can grow because of the protection of the skin. So humility is the protection of our bhakti. It's our protection of our bhakti. And humility is understood that whatever I can do, or whatever qualities I have, it's simply the mercy of the Lord. Coming through the mercy of His, your devotees. It's a channel. And therefore, a devotee is always begging for mercy. A devotee is a mercy beggar. Sometimes we think of a beggar as someone who's poor, right? And someone who's in need of something. Yes, we are in need. We're in need of the mercy of the Lord because here we are in this material world struggling. But with the mercy of the Lord, Bukam Karoti Vachalam, Pangu Lagite Giriam, Yat Kripa Tanaham Bande, Shigurum Dina Tarinam. It is explained that a blind man, he can see the stars. A lame man can walk over mountains, and a dumb man can recite beautiful poetry. And Prabhupada adds to that. He said, yes, even a fool can give a class. In one lecture he says that. So what does it mean? That by the mercy of the Lord, everything becomes successful. And Krishna wants to give His mercy. He's full of His mercy. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually expresses that in many, many statements. He says, I have come into this world and I have a great treasure. It's called love of God. And I'm not happy simply to have it myself. I want to give it to others. I've come to share this treasure with others. But how much can I do? I'm only one person. But I have this store. It's a storehouse. It's a huge storehouse. It has so many sweet fruit in there. And I'm tasting the fruit. And I want to distribute the fruit. But I'm only one person. How much can I distribute? And how much can I taste? So therefore, come and help me. Taste it yourself, and then distribute it. And that way, so many will, others will also taste the sweet fruit of love of God. So the Lord, as we mentioned earlier, is all powerful. He can distribute it by himself. But he says, I can't do it. Why? He wants to give us the credit. He's asking. So this is a great opportunity to take part in one of the Lord's personal pastimes. We are so fortunate to be here at this time, just after the advent of Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Mahaprabhu comes once in every 1,000 Yuga cycles. Calculated in years, that's 4,320,000,000 years. Lord Chaitanya comes, Lord Krishna comes. So it's considered to be extremely rare that both these personalities come. And it was in this particular Kali Yuga, only 529 years ago, that Lord Chaitanya appeared. So you consider yourself very fortunate. I mean, if you look at fortune, sometimes we think, well, I don't have much money. You know, I'm struggling with this, I'm struggling that. But look at the facility we have in order to take part in the Lord's personal pastimes. This is his pastime. He's brought that pastime of love of God into this world, and he wants to give it to everyone. And he's asking those who have it, taste it some more. Get yourself full of it. Taste it so sweetly. And then distribute it as much as you can to others. And when you distribute it, he says, and the thing about this storehouse, the more you distribute it, the more it grows. It doesn't get less. When you have something in this world, if you have money, you give it away, it becomes less, right? If you have some material item, you give it away, it reduces. The love of God works in the opposite way. When you give it, it grows. You get it, the person you give it to gets it, and Krishna becomes happy and gives you more to give to others, and then it continues to grow more and more. So this is Krishna's mercy. So he's asking us to take the mercy. So much mercy available. It's like if you walk into a room, this is using an opposite, everybody's smoking, and the whole area is full of smoke. You start coughing, right? You can't see because it's cloudy, full of smoke. All you have to do is walk in there, and immediately you want to walk out. It's so thick, but love of God is like that also. It's so thick that as soon as you're within it, you can taste it immediately. And we want to taste it more and more. So Lord Chaitanya has come to distribute the holy name of Krishna to every town and village. And guess what? He's not happy until everybody gets it. He demands a lot. He doesn't want just some people to get it. He wants to give it to everybody. He gave it to Jagai and Manai just to show that I want to give it to those persons who are the least qualified to receive it. The most sinful, the most degraded, the most decrepit, the most unlikely persons to receive it. Yeah, we have the example. We're preaching in prisons, and we're meeting people who are, you know, pretty heavy criminals who have killed other people. And now they're chanting Hare Krishna. And now they're actually offering their food and also following a kamasi. So how is that heard? There's one story. There was one girl. This was in South India. She was a prostitute. And she would work at this one bar. And then when the customers come in, she would do her service to the customers. And then after one customer came in and gave her a Bhagavad Gita. So she thought, okay. So while she was doing her job in between, she would read Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita and performing her service as a prostitute. So one day, the bar got raided and everyone was put in jail, including her. So there she was in jail, and she still had her Bhagavad Gita. This time she didn't have her profession anymore, just her Bhagavad Gita. And she just kept reading the Gita more and more and more. And finally, she started to understand what the Gita was saying. That actually, your relationship with everything in this world has no real value unless it connects with Krishna. And then she started to become Krishna conscious. When she got out, she gave up her profession, got married, had a nice family, and became a wonderful devotee. Simply by getting the mercy of the Bhagavad Gita. So how much, there's so many examples, how people's lives have gone from hell to heaven, you might say, overnight, simply by the mercy of the Lord. And either the scriptures that they receive, or the chanting of the holy names, either one. I remember we were doing this, like sometimes on New Year's Eve, right? You go out and do Harinam. Do you do that sometimes? We could do that on the New Year's Eve in America. In America, it's really, really cold. Of course, here it is also. So we would go out around midnight and chant and dance. And the people would be out celebrating the beginning of the New Year. You know how they celebrate, right? Yeah, they take all kinds of intoxications. So sometimes you go into areas. So one time we went to this one area, a lot of people were hanging around, just partying and drunk, and so we were chanting Hare Krishna. And one devotee had his video camera, so he was videoing the whole thing. So later on we looked at the video, and it was two guys. They joined the kirtan party. Both of them were drunk. And they were like jumping up and down. And one of them says to the other, "What are they saying?" The other one says, "I don't know, but it's really nice." He didn't even know the words. He was trying to hear the words. He was so drunk. But it was so nice that his party turned into a Harinam party. This is the problem. This is the mercy of the holy name. It just sweeps people in. Like when I came in today, when I heard the kirtan, I wasn't sure what was being chanted. I was listening, trying to listen to the particular mantra he was chanting. It took me a little while to hear, okay, Shivana Mahaprabhu. But when I came in, immediately I could feel the spiritual energy. And it took me a little while to focus on actually what mantra was being said. Because, you know, I'm a little dull, it takes a little while. If you give me the Hare Krishna Bhava mantra, I can figure that one out. The other ones, I was a little slow. So, but it didn't matter, because the spiritual energy was already in the air. And it just draws you right in. You just pulled into the energy. So the spiritual energy is coming as the mercy of the Lord. So we can look at our lives and say, whatever success I have, whatever I am, it's simply by the mercy of the Lord. And the mercy is so available. Someone came to Prabhupada and said, "Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Prabhupada, please give me a mercy." Prabhupada said, "I'm giving you, just take it." What's the problem? It's available, just take it. What is that mercy? Associating with devotees, serving devotees, chanting the Hare Krishna mantra, taking Krishna prasadam, and living according to the directions of the spiritual master. That's the mercy. It's simple. The activities are quite simple. But the benefit is inconceivable, because it brings our consciousness, our whole life, to a different level of existence. When we look at this world and we think, what value has, things of this world, unless we're Krishna conscious? If you're not Krishna conscious, you just look at this world. I mean, if you're Krishna conscious, you just look at this world and say, how can people live like that? It looks so miserable. They're suffering, and they think they're happy. A person gets intoxicated, thinks he's happy, has some sexual fairy, thinks he's happy. But the body thinks, guy's suffering. He's miserable. He's trying to enjoy, and he's just creating more and more suffering for himself. So the body can see that others are in need of the mercy. They're in need of the mercy. So when we have the mercy, we can just look. We're not attracted to what people find happiness in this world. That's Krishna's mercy. Therefore, one of the main features of Krishna's mercy is he helps you to understand the futility of material sense gratification. That's a powerful form of mercy. When you understand this world is not a place for happiness. It's simply a place for struggle. Happiness comes when we accept the mercy of the Lord through the process of devotional service. And the holy name is the mercy manifestation of the holy name. That holy name can take you all the way to Vaikuntha, leave you there. If you want to go someplace else, it'll take you there too. It's like a powerful train that brings your consciousness all the way up. But practice staying absorbed in Krishna's name. The more you're absorbed in the name, the more you can taste the happiness in Krishna's name. It's like we go to kirtan programs, right? And now we're having these programs around the world where we have 5 days of kirtan, 4 days of kirtan, 24-hour kirtans. And after you finish a weekend like that, you're just saturated with the holy name. You 12 hours of kirtan that night, you go to sleep, and all you do here is the holy name. Right? You wake up, the holy name's still there. After a few days, it kind of goes down a little bit, a lot sometimes. So staying in the mercy of the holy name means to become absorbed in Krishna's name. In Krishna's name, everything is in Krishna's name. One time one senior devotee was giving a class, and Prabhupada was sitting there. This was really hard. Imagine Prabhupada sitting there and you're giving a class, and you have to give a class to the devotees, and Prabhupada's listening to your class, right? Can you imagine how, I guess, nervous you would be? So this one devotee, he was there, and he started to speak. And he said, Krishna is in his name. And Prabhupada stopped him. And Krishna Prabhupada said, where in his name is he? And the Buddha thought, oh, that's not right. Krishna is not in his name. Krishna is his name. There's a difference. So the name of Krishna is Krishna. And therefore, everything is there in the name. The entire spiritual world, all the qualities, all the pastimes, all the names, all the forms, all the associates, everything, the entire existence, spiritual and material, and all its glory is found in Krishna's name. Do we believe that? Or we just think, yeah, it sounds like a eulogy, right? Hyperbole. Yeah, the scriptures just say that because they want you to get you a chance. It's not really like that. Actually, one cannot glorify the holy name enough. So any glorification of the holy name is actually falls short of the actual glorification of the holy name. So in other words, it's an understatement. You can't overstate the glories of the holy name. It's not possible. Therefore, just like you can't describe Krishna fully, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Madhusanam Sahasreshu Kastyat Yatati Siraye Yatatam Abhisithanam Kastyat Vaiti Tattvatam. Out of many millions of persons who actually take the devotional service, hardly one achieves perfection. And out of those that achieve perfection, nobody knows me in truth. He says that again in the same chapter. What is that verse? He says, what does he say? I know everything that's happened in the past. I know everything that is happening in the present. And I know all things yet to come. I also know all living entities. And then he ends by saying, but me, no one knows. No one can know Krishna. It's not possible. Even Krishna cannot know himself. That's how great he is. That's why he becomes Lord Chaitanya, just to find out how great he is. He takes the position of Radharani in the mood of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, just to taste his own qualities and glories and sweetness, because he can't taste it directly. He doesn't know how wonderful he is. Therefore, only Radharani knows. Therefore, because he wants to taste his own glories and understand what she is, what she's attracted to, he becomes Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Just to taste the happiness she's feeling, because he can't taste that same happiness. This is, Krishna is incomplete because he can't taste the happiness that Radharani is tasting. He has to become Radharani in order to taste that happiness. Therefore, he appears in this world as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, just to taste her love, her happiness, and her attraction for him. Krishna is walking along, and he walks past this beautiful, big, reflecting pillar. It's a shiny pillar. And he passes it, and he walks back, and he looks, wow, who's that? And he looks, it's me. Wow, he gets attracted to his own self. Don't try yourself. That's not the idea. I mean, you might get up in the morning and look in the mirror once and get a little excited, but after a while it gets changes, you know. In other words, it takes a little while to get to that point. But Krishna, he's so attractive that he attracts himself. So this is Krishna. And so therefore, no one can understand Krishna. Therefore, no one can understand the glories of the holy name. It's not possible. Because that holy name is the embodiment of Krishna himself. When someone asks Prabhupada, in every age Krishna comes in as an incarnation. How has he come in this age? He said, in the sound of his name. Kali Kale, Nama Rupa, Krishna Avatar. There's a verse from Chaitanya Charitamrita. That Kali Kale, in this age of Kali, Nam Rup, the form of the name, Krishna Avatar. Is Krishna coming in this world? So he's actually descended in the form of the holy name. And when he descends, his names come, his qualities come, his pastimes come, his forms come, and all his atonious eternal associates, they all come in the sound of his name. So how much are we tasting? How much is available to be tasted? Sometimes we come to a kirtan, just like I was just reading this particular pastime of the life of Narottam Das Thakur. Narottam Das Thakur's, his qualities of devotion were indescribable. So, to kind of fast forward this particular pastime, he was asked, actually, by the devotees, to glorify Lord Chaitanya. Actually, it was his idea to hold a Gaura Purnima festival 50 years after the disappearance of Lord Chaitanya. And there were devotees in Vrindavan, there were devotees in Mayapur, and there were devotees in Jagannath Puri. And they were separate. Many of them were feeling very unhappy because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had left. And their lives were just, they were just maintaining their lives in separation from the Lord. So Narottam Das Thakur decided to bring all the devotees together for a grand festival in the Gaura Purnima celebration. So in his hometown called Khetrigram, where he was born as the son of a king, Raj Kumar Das. And he left home, became a sadhu, met Lokanath Das Goswami, got initiated, and gave up all his inheritance But then he returned to his home to preach Krishna consciousness to his friends and family members. And then he decided to, after seeing everyone again, how to hold a big festival and invite all the Vaishnavas. So it was also a deity installation ceremony where there were different deities of the Lord were going to be installed. So thousands and thousands of devotees came from all over India just to be there. All the associates of Mahaprabhu came who had were still left after the disappearance of the Lord. And then the first day, after everyone got their places to sit and they had their rooms, everything taken care of. The next day, the beginning of the morning, they started a fire yoga. And then they did a deity installation. And six sets of deities of the Lord were installed by Srinivasacharya, who was doing the puja, and Narottam Das Thakur, who was actually doing the worship during the puja. So then it was time for kirtan. And Narottam Das Thakur was asked to lead the kirtan. So Devadas was on the mridanga, and he was considered the best mridanga player out of all the devotees. So they all came together, and thousands of devotees, and they began the kirtan. And Narottam Das just had a small pair of kartals, and he was singing so beautifully, so sweetly, chanting Krishna's holy name, the Maha Mantra. Gradually, the kirtan started to increase more and more and more. Now, Janava Devi was there. Who else was there? The son of Advaitacharya, Chintananda, was there. The son of Mukunda, Raghunanda Thakur, was there. All the great Vaishnavas who were still sons and relatives of some of the associates of Lord Chaitanya all came to this kirtan. And Narottam Das is leading, and he's singing so sweetly, so devotionally. And gradually the kirtan is building, and everyone is dancing, and finally ecstasy starts to enter, and everyone is really, really happy. At that point, when the ecstasy reached a certain level, the most amazing thing happened. Lord Chaitanya, the entire Panchatattva, along with all of the departed associates of Lord Chaitanya, appeared in the kirtan. Not as a dream, not as a vision, but personally present. Everyone saw them. And you can imagine, and they were dancing like crazy to Narottam's kirtan. Narottam stayed absorbed in the kirtan, but around everyone was going mad. It's described in detail in this particular narration that people were crying, rolling on the ground, falling unconscious, unable to maintain any kind of sanity, and just the holy name was just going, and Lord Chaitanya was in ecstasy. The ecstasy reached so much that Lord Nityananda grabbed Narottam Das Thakur and started dancing with him. Narottam was amazed. There he was dancing with Lord Nityananda. And the kirtan went on. Everyone saw their friends, their relatives, and their parents, associates. It went on so. And people were stunned. Some were so stunned they couldn't move. Their eyes were just like. Others were on the ground crying. Others were unconscious. Others were just singing at the top of their voice. It was complete madness. And it went on and on for hours. It was devastating. Finally, at one point, Lord Chaitanya disappeared. And you can imagine what happened after that. Everyone felt like our life has just left us. Everything just changed. And the ecstasy turned into the ecstasy of separation rather than the ecstasy of meeting. And but Narottam continued with the kirtan. Finally, after many hours of sleep, and for days, not only days, but for weeks and months after, everyone was talking about that kirtan. Lord Chaitanya invested within the heart of Narottam the power of kirtan. He said that there will soon be a person before he left the planet who will come to revolutionize the whole style of kirtan and will bring a new style of kirtan into the hearts and minds of the world. And of course, some devotees actually say, and it's actually proven, that the Manipuris were descendants of Narottam Das Thakur, the Manipuri style of kirtan. You've seen the Manipuris? The way they dance, the way they sing, it's really ecstatic, just watching them. So this is Lord Chaitanya's mercy. He empowers those who are fully surrendered to bring the holy name to the world. So where can we find more mercy than that? There's no more mercy than that. Therefore, Prabhupada used to say, you may be intelligent, you may have many good qualities, then okay, use it. But use it to try to understand how merciful Lord Chaitanya is. And he said, you won't be able to do it. You can't understand his mercy. It's not possible. When Prabhupada came to one temple in America in 1975, this was the Atlanta, Georgia temple. And devotees from everywhere in America heard Prabhupada was coming. So they took buses, planes, cars, and drove. And the temple was, the devotees couldn't fit in the temple. Prabhupada had come. This was the end of February 1975. You could hear those lectures. And it was described. I wanted to go, I remember. I wasn't able to get away from my service. So I missed that particular event. But the devotees are went. The temple is like, you could take this building and make it three times as big. That's about the size of the temple. The temple was full, and devotees were outside, looking in the windows. And there was a line behind them. There's so many devotees. This is the winter time. Of course, it was in Georgia, which is in the southern part of America, so the winters are kind of mild. So it's like about 15 degrees, something like that. So, and Prabhupada comes, and the temple is full, and mostly Sankirtan devotees, and the energy is so high that when Prabhupada walks in, it's like the energy is a lot, is like electric, you know. The devotees are so full of enthusiasm. Prabhupada's here. And Prabhupada comes. And in the Atlanta, Georgia temple, the main deities in the temple are big brass deities of Gaudatai. They're in the center altar. There's three altars. At that time, Gaudatai were in the center, and on this side was Jagannath. And that this side, the temple, the altar was empty. Now, after Prabhupada left, they installed Radha Krishna on this side. Gaudatai is in the middle, and Jagannath still on this side. So Gaudatai is the center of deities. Now Prabhupada comes in, he sits down, and then everything becomes quiet. And Prabhupada starts to talk about Lord Chaitanya's mercy. And he starts to describe, these two brothers, Nitai Gaur, they are so kind, they are so merciful. And at one point, after speaking for less than a minute, Prabhupada stops. He can't speak anymore. And closes his eyes, and tears are running down his face. The whole temple becomes completely silent and stunned, watching Prabhupada's ecstasy. Can't speak anymore. And he's just thinking in his heart, how merciful are these two persons, Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda. Because he's a pure devotee of Lord Nityananda, he understands their mercy. And he's overwhelmed with ecstasy. He's silent, he's speechless. Finally, after a few moments, which seemed like about a year, because when something like that happens, every minute is like an hour. Time goes so slow. Slow. It gets so slow. It seemed like forever. And finally, after the Prabhupada came out of Exeter, he said, have kirtan. He couldn't speak. He was overwhelmed with love for Lord Nityananda. So we get a little bit of the understanding from the example of the pure devotees. What is the mercy of Lord Nityananda? We can't understand full the mercy there, but the mercy is available for everybody. It's like an unlimited being. Sometimes we use the example. When it rains, the rain goes on the rocks, it goes on the ocean, it goes everywhere. Well, what does the rocks and the ocean have to do? They don't have any rain, need for rain. It's only the agricultural fields and the forests that may benefit from the rain. But still, the rain is going everywhere. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy is like an ocean or a great shower of devotion just falling upon the world in this particular age. And what is that ocean? The Harinam Sankirtan. So those who take part in the Harinam Sankirtan movement are in a constant shower of the bliss of Lord Chaitanya's mercy. It's like you get into a shower, you turn on the water, and it's coming out fast, and it feels so good. Especially if you're tired. It just revives you. It gives you energy, it gives you enthusiasm, it gives you refreshment. Lord Chaitanya, as soon as we come into a kirtan, we absorb ourselves in chanting the holy names of the Lord. Kirtan is so powerful that there's one story. I mean, this is an example. There was two very senior devotees in the whole time of Prabhupada. They had a problem with each other. They were both leaders, but they didn't talk to each other. They had the personal problems. So there was one festival, and both of them were at the festival. And the kirtan was going on. And both of them were in the kirtan. It was like a big circle. One was standing on one side, and one was on the other side. They were complete opposite sides. So one very intelligent devotee was thinking, I have to somehow do something to bring these two devotees, who are great devotees in our movement, to become friends again. So while the kirtan was going on, both were dancing on opposite sides. So this other person started to dance. And then he got everybody to dance even more. And then he danced over to each of those persons and pushed them into the center of the kirtan. And now they're dancing close to each other. And they're just enjoying the kirtan. Finally, he gets in closer and he pushes both of them together. And now they're holding each other and dancing. And all of a sudden they're realizing, I guess I do like you. The holy name made them forget all of their, what we say, differences and whatever problems they had. And, you know, that solved the problem with their differences. That's Krishna's holy name. It makes enemies into friends. And it changes black into white, or changes, you know, something that is, you know, suspicious into something that is very desirable. This is the Krishna's only name. So what can we speak about mercy? Therefore, we have that opportunity to chant Krishna's name and to, you know, take part in Krishna's kirtans and to distribute this mercy to others. And therefore, anandam bhuti vardhanam. It's an ocean of material, of spiritual happiness. Radharani and Krishna are there. Radharani looks at Krishna. She sees how beautiful Krishna is. She becomes happy and her beauty becomes more. Krishna looks at Radharani and sees that her beauty becomes more. He becomes happy and his beauty increases. Radharani sees that Krishna's beauty is even more. She becomes even happier, then her beauty increases. And then Krishna looks at Radharani. Her beauty is even more because of her happiness, and he becomes more happy, then he becomes more beautiful. And this just keeps going. So, you know, there's no limit. I mean, don't try that with your husband and wife. It may work one or two times, but after that it kind of loses it. Vyasa. But you can do that with Krishna. If Krishna sees how happy you are, he becomes happy, then you also become beautiful. Because when you're happy, you're beautiful. When you're not happy, even if you're beautiful, you're not. You may be beautiful by material descriptions and standards, but if you're miserable, that's more your personality presentation. So happiness, even if you're ugly, of course, the soul is not ugly, the soul is beautiful. But when the soul experiences happiness, the body actually becomes beautiful. Right? Devotees are beautiful, even if they're by material standards, not so beautiful. Because it's the happiness that they're experiencing Krishna consciousness that makes them beautiful. And if you're beautiful by material standards and you become Krishna conscious, wow, you become more beautiful. So what is the beauty? The beauty is in the soul. And the soul reflects that beauty through the body. And the body becomes more and more attractive because the soul is experiencing the happiness like that. So therefore, the devotees all look beautiful. And even the materialists who have some material beauty, we look at them and we say, looks like a witch. Or a pig. Something like Ravana. Yeah, so, even material beauty loses its, attractiveness when people are not happy. And happiness, natural happiness, is the position of the soul's relationship with Krishna through the holy name. So this is Krishna's name. So therefore, when we talk about Krishna, we can only say he's the most merciful. Out of all his qualities, and he has unlimited qualities, his merciful quality is the most glorious quality. Because he gives that mercy in so many ways, and by that mercy, everything becomes wonderful. It says that by the presence of the moon within the sky becomes beautiful. By the presence of a qualified sun within the household becomes beautiful. When a wife has a qualified husband, she becomes beautiful. This is Bhagavatam explaining these things. Therefore, when Krishna is present, everything becomes wonderful and beautiful. So bring Krishna into our lives by bringing Krishna's holy name into our lives more and more and more. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Shiva Prabhupada
ki jai. Solan Chandramali Maharaj ki
jai.
Any questions? Yes.
How does
its
soul looks like?
What's the word,
Jana? Yeah, I'm not sure about A. Is it like that or like that?
Jana.
Jana?
Yes.
Jana,
J-A-N-A? Mm-hmm.
A. How does it run?
What do you need, Maharaj?
Here.
You mean like this?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. We're drinking only jhana. Jhana means
jhana.
The word J-A-N-A, Mahajan. Jhana means soul. Maha means great. So when you say Mahajan, Jhana means great soul. So Jhana refers to soul. It also can refer to light, like that, because the soul is characterized by light. So Jhana means light, Jhana means soul. Jhana could also be called beauty. It has different meanings. But the standard name is soul. So is that what you're asking?
I want to know how does it write this A. Is it like that or like...
Oh, is it long A or short A? Is that it? There's jhana and jhana. Jhana, jhana. I don't know. I'm not sure. I'm not so expert at these, all these intricacies of Sanskrit. Anyway, it's a nice word. Maha means great, jhana means person or soul, great soul, mahajana.
And atma means?
Atma means soul also. Atma can mean soul, atma can mean body, atma can mean mind. So atma has many meanings. It depends how you use the word. In what context you're putting the word gives the meaning of the word like that. Atmananda, the bliss of, ananda means soul, the bliss, happiness. Atma means the bliss of the soul. Atmaram means the Rama means happiness, joy, the joy of the soul. So Atma is there, but Atma has different meanings. You study Sanskrit?
I just don't know where to look.
The Sanskrit language is a beautiful language. It's the word San means complete. And script means language or written. That language is which is complete or perfect. If you study Sanskrit, of course it takes 12 years to learn the grammar. It's a great study. And then you can really understand Shastra deep. Because the deeper meanings in Shastra are also hidden within this great Sanskrit grammar. That's why those who have Sanskrit knowledge, they can take the Shastras and explain it in different ways accordingly. But we don't have to spend so much time. We can just listen to Prabhupada's lectures and lectures by others, and then we can understand a little bit about it. One thing we should do is learn how to pronounce the Sanskrit properly. That helps. Because we're grown up in Western countries, we're not familiar with Sanskrit, and therefore we make mistakes in the pronunciation. And if you make a mistake in pronunciation, you can actually change the meaning of what you're trying to say. But Krishna knows what you're trying to say. But scholars, if they hear you, they'll think you don't know anything. Like we say, Hare Haraye Namma Krishna Yadavaya. Some people say, Hare Hara Namma Krishna. You say, Hare Hara, you're saying, all glories to Lord Shiva. If you say, Hey Hare Haraye, you're saying, all glories to Krishna. One time Prabhupada was talking to his devotees. We sing this one prayer. Samsara dhavanala lila loka
Tanaya karunya granaya natha
Atasya kalyana gunarna vasya
Ande guru shri charanaya linda.
He did a grin. If you say guru, you're saying guru, but some people would say guru. If you say guru, you're saying cow. So one time Prabhupada said, I know you mean well, but please don't call your spiritual master a cow. So, you know, the Sanskrit is very intricate, and the emphasis and the pronunciation, because it can change the meaning. But fortunately, Krishna has a certain quality, which is his quality of mercy also. He's called Bhava, he Janardana. Bhavamihi Janardana means he takes the essence of something. So even if you're chanting it wrongly, but you're meaning something right, he takes what you mean and not what you say. That's Krishna. But Prabhupada would always instruct us, try to say it right. It's like we sing, Namo Namo Tulsi Krishna Preyasi. So some people say, Namo Namo Tulasi Krishna Preyasi. It's not Tulasi, it's Tulsi. If you say Tulasi, you're saying two lassies. Give me two lassies, please. Thursday. It's not Tulasi, it's Tulasi. Tulasi. But we all say it wrong, right? Everybody sings Tulasi. So, I mean, we make these mistakes. So, therefore, Prabhupada encouraged us. One time in Japan in 1972, he gave a Bhagavatam class, and he spent 45 minutes doing the word-for-word pronunciation just to teach the devotees how to say the Sanskrit. So we would get an idea on the pronunciation. But even if you make a mistake and you mean something, Krishna takes the meaning. But the spiritual master wants you to say it right. So that's why he makes these points. Sanskrit's a beautiful language. It's so beautiful. It's the language of the demigods in the higher planets. It's come to this planet. The philologists who study the history of language cannot trace out the origin of Sanskrit on this planet, because there is no origin here. It's coming from higher realms and comes to this planet. So Sanskrit is actually the language of the gods. So it's nice just to chant verses. We take the verses. Prabhupada would sometimes chant these different verses. Give me a verse. What's a nice one? Anyone can think of one. Pancha kaupata rupischa kripa sindhu pevacha adhidhanam bhavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. So nice. Just by chanting, that's why when we have Bhagavatam class every day in our temples, we responsibly chant the verses. Why? Because it gives power, enthusiasm, and spiritual energy to the beginning of the class. And it just raises the energy up. That's what Prabhupada would have the devotees responsibly chant the verses. It just picks up the spiritual energy. And devotees learn how to chant Sanskrit. And there's many meters for Sanskrit too. You can chant in different tunes, different melodies. Bhagavad Bhakti Goswami, one of the six Goswamis in Vrindavan, he knew the Srimad Bhagavatam, and he could recite every verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam in three different meters, in three different ways. And that's what he would do. He would just sit in Vrindavan, and he would read Bhagavatam all day, because Lord Chaitanya told him to do that. And he would chant it out loud, and people would come and sit around and listen to his chanting of the Bhagavatam. And he would sing it, because Sanskrit is actually a song type language. You can sing it. When you speak, you sing. It's coming more from the heart rather than from, you know, the mind. Well, Sanskrit is a very beautiful language. Croatian is nice too. I actually like Croatian better than English, but I don't know it so well. It's a very sweet language. You'll find a lot of words in your language is also there in the Sanskrit. You can see that. I remember when I first came to Croatia, and I had to give my first initiation here. They gave me a list of names not to use because they had different meanings, right? You can't give a person a new name Rupa, right? Because Rupa means?
Oh, no.
Rata?
Door.
Kanta?
Kanta.
We won't mention that one. Radha Kanta means lover of Radharani. It's the name for Krishna. So, wait a minute. So the language is there, but actually some of the original meanings of the language is still within the derivatives or in the expressional languages, like the local languages. Like there's one place, I think there's a village called Radha, somewhere like that. So you'll find that because when King Yayati was on the throne, he wanted to trade his old age for his son's youth so he could enjoy more sense gratification in a youthful body. And his sons refused, except for one. And he got angry at his sons and he banished them. And they left, and Prabhupada said they started the Greek and the Roman empires. And from there, that spread throughout Europe like that. He said also the Turkish Empire, the Greek Empire, the Roman Empire are all offshoots of the Vedic culture. So all of European culture is really an offshoot of Vedic culture. And so there's a lot of connection there. So you'll find many of the Sanskrit words are also in the local languages. I don't know if this is interesting or not, but since you mentioned it. Anything else? Any other questions? Yes.
Maharaj, you nice describe about kirtan. Can you a little bit show how it look in practical way for people who never see this?
So Mahananda wants to dance. So go ahead, show us the Swami step. So you can stand up. Stand over here. Okay. Raise your arms like this. And then move your right foot in front of your left foot. And then put it back. And then left foot in front of right foot. And put it back. And so when the chanter is chanting, you're like this. You're taking the energy into your heart. And when you're speaking, you're giving that energy up like this. Okay, there you go. Ecstasy. And if you smile, it looks even better. And if you close your eyes, it really looks good. Because you can't worship the Lord with your eyes open. That's a rule. Thank you. Chanting, dancing, and feasting. Smiling. Okay, you're smiling while you're feasting. So, yeah, these are the processes of Krishna consciousness. Dancing is an expression of happiness. When you're happy, you dance. Sometimes we dance just to dance, and that's nice, because it actually is part of the process. But when you dance naturally, and you just feel inspired to dance, that means there's some happiness awakening within your heart from the chanting of the holy name. And it becomes strong, and you get up, and you dance. So, here for Lord Chaitanya, you see Lord Chaitanya, how often did he leave kirtan? He didn't leave many times. There's no still stories of him leaving kirtan. But he was always dancing. Lord Nityananda and Lord Chaitanya were always dancing. It's not that he didn't want to leave kirtan, but he would rather dance. Because the dancing is an expression of ecstasy. The dancers get more fun than the leaders. Of course, the leaders also gets happiness to see everyone else dancing. When the leader is leading and he sees everyone dancing and singing enthusiastic, that awakens his devotion even more. But the ones who are actually receiving that energy, and it's all coming together as a unified energy, they're experiencing great joy. So that's our process. Prabhupada said it's simply a big spiritual party. People go, they spend money just to go to parties. We could just have a party anytime. Sing and dance. And then when you get tired, you eat. And it's not so good. And then Lord Chaitanya's program is actually like this. It's not like you sing and then dance and then eat and then go home. That wasn't Lord Chaitanya's program. You sing, you dance, you get tired, you eat, you get some energy, you go back to singing again. And then you go for more, and then you dance some more, get more tired, and then you eat some more. And then you go back. You don't need a big feast, you just need to keep you going. And then you keep doing that, and then you just, it's just like continuous. It goes on for days like that, you don't stop. And you forget about sleeping, you forget about everything else. That's Lord Chaitanya's movement. And it's just described in one bhaja. They sang and they got tired. Then they took a little prashanam and then they began again. And then they sang some more and danced some more. Took a little more prashanam and danced again. Because prashanam is also spiritual. It gives you spiritual enthusiasm, energy like that. And those who can't dance, it says that there's persons who can't dance, they dance within their hearts. And Lord Chaitanya, in the Gaura Arti, it's described that there were many persons during that Gaura Arti, they simply were not dancing outwardly, but they were dancing in their hearts. So then you can dance in your heart also, and that is also dancing. Maybe the body is not able to dance for whatever reason. One can dance in their hearts and their minds. I think everyone wants prashad. Okay. All right, thank you very much.
Jai.